To my eye, there aren't very many insects that look as impressive in flight as a scarab beetle. This scarab, a grapevine or spotted June beetle, is a huge lumbering insect. Yet in the air, the details of its movements are sophisticated and graceful. If this one were to fly near you, you'd hear a frantic buzz or flicker of its wings as it went past. But here, seeing them like this at 6,000 frames per second, each wing is a steady oar, rowing through the air, carrying the beetle in an arching and upward flight path.
In this video, you'll see flight footage from 12 beetles across 10 taxonomic families, and that's just a tiny sliver of overall beetle biodiversity. Now usually, I narrate these videos, but I thought it'd be fun to get a guest narrator, and the first person I thought of on the top of my list was one of my favorite writers and comedians, Joe Pera, and I can't tell you how thrilled I am that he said yes. So let's get back to the beetles with Joe Pera.
This is an oriental beetle. And watch what happens with its wings as it preps for flight. The hardened protective forewings, the elytra, are raised out of the way. Underneath are the flight-powered hind wings, and they're folded in half. To unfold them, the beetle starts flapping, and it takes them two or three beats to snap into place. These beetles are one of two scarab species that, over the last 100 years, have expanded their range to become one of the more common garden pests in the eastern U.S. The other scarab that might be in your garden is this, the Japanese beetle. These, despite being pests, are pretty attractive beetles. They're easily identified by their iridescent green body and those white tufts of hair lining the sides of their abdomen. Like the last two species you just saw, Japanese beetles fly in the same style, leading with their fanned-out antennae and trailing by dragging behind their long tarsal claws. This is something completely different, a water scavenger beetle. These beetles are aquatic, but the adults are agile flyers and will fly to disperse between habitats. Look at its legs as it flies and notice the slender spike of a last segment. That's actually a cluster of long fan-like hairs that form a paddle it uses when swimming. And here's what that looks like. When they're swimming, only the middle and hind legs are involved. The front legs are folded up and held against the body. The alternating side-to-side stroke distinguishes them from other diving beetles, which use both legs in unison. These beetles also have a keel that runs under the midline of their body. It looks like a sharp, spine-like rudder underneath them as they swim. This next one is a sap-feeding beetle called the picnic beetle. The name comes from an attraction to fruits, vinegar, and fermented drinks. In natural habitats, they're attracted to this fermented sap oozing out of a distressed tree. Picnic beetles feed on the sap, but they also help themselves to snack on some of the other insects there too. This is a jewel beetle. You'll see as it raises the wings, the hind wings are a perfect match in size to the fore wings. Once they're raised, you can also catch glimpses of the iridescent emerald green abdomen. Jewel beetles are named that because a lot of them have brightly colored iridescent bodies. This one was found hanging out amongst the leaves of a persimmon tree. Jewel beetles are known to feed on pollen, nectar, and foliage, and quick to take wing, like this, if their perch on a stem or leaf is disturbed. Next is the tumbling flower beetle. These beetles are also common on vegetation and flowers, and when you see them, they usually look wedge-shaped with a humped back, but in flight, they look a bit different. As these ones raise their wings, look between their thorax and abdomen. You can see how the two body segments separate. You can see it a little better on this shot, where the beetle takes off and flies in profile to the camera. The common name of the tumbling flower beetle comes from what they do to rapidly escape from a predator. In these shots, the scary predator is the paintbrush. The first shot on the left is going to show you the tumble in a slightly slower than real time, and then on the right, you'll see it again slowed down even more. What's happening is the beetles are rotating their hind legs around to point all the way forward beyond their head, and then they rapidly rotate them back across their bodies to flick themselves off the ground and into a tumble. They're allowed to do that because their hind legs attach to their bodies via a screw-like joint that allows them to rotate 270 degrees. These beetles are one of only a few insects with leg joints that work like that. These are tiger beetles. Tiger beetles do everything fast. They are the fastest running insect, going about the same speed as you or I would when jogging. Most beetles will raise their wings, position their body, and hold their legs up before they start to try to fly. Tiger beetles do all of that at once while leaping into the air. Compare what you just saw the tiger beetle do with this, a clay-colored leaf beetle. Both the recording speed, 6,000 frames per second, and the playback speed, 30 frames per second, are the same for each sequence. But as you see here, a more normal beetle like this takes its time when getting ready to fly. This one raises its wing and positions its body at a 45 degree angle. The takeoff is more or less a vertical one from that standing, outstretched posture. There's no jump, and the wing beats lift the beetle into the air. One thing you notice with all this video is that a lot of the beetles have more or less the same strategy and style of orienting their bodies in flight. For instance, these three beetles from different taxonomic families. On the left is a soldier beetle. In the middle, a small flat cerambycid or longhorn beetle, and on the right is a checkered beetle. These three have similarly elongated body shapes and all take to the air standing and belly first with their legs fully outstretched.
So those are some of the most interesting beetles I've been able to film over the past year. Thanks again to Joe Pera for narrating this. I'll link to his channel in the video description below. For now, thanks for watching.